Thank you very much for inviting me. My name is Philip Wohlgenannt and I would like to present my first conference or my last conference paper here. I'm from the Vorarlberg University of Applied Sciences and yeah, this conference paper is part of the FFG project Digital Energy Twin and has the title Demand Side Management of a Battery Supported Manufacturing Process with On-Site Generation. There we are basically using digital twins to estimate energy consumption, which is then later used for optimization. Let's start with the motivation. At our university, we have a laboratory setup where we can simulate the essential aspects of the production of goods, including parts manufacturing, assembly, logistics, and warehousing in real scenarios. Here you can see 5 robots, a milling machine, a transportation machine, and on the monitor you can already see the digital representation of the complete system. We now take this lab and add a battery storage and a PV system to it. With that, we are able to simulate and optimize the energy supply, the energy storage, and the energy consumption of a real system. But first, let me show you the system architecture. Left, you have the real factory, in the middle, the optimizer, and right, the digital twin. First, the real factory always gets the production order list. These are unsorted production orders, which should be finished until the end of the day. The energy consumption of these jobs isn't known in advance. So the real factory forwards them to the optimizer, which forwards them to the digital twin. With the digital twin, we can then estimate the energy consumption of every single order, even for completely flexible production processes or processes that have never been run before. With the results of the digital twin, the optimizer can then optimize the production schedule and the battery control of the system. In the remaining presentation, the focus will be on the optimizer because that was my main responsibility. So let's talk about the problem statement of the optimizer. As inputs, we have the PV prediction, the production order list, and the incentive function. As incentive function, price functions like the spot market price for electricity can be used. As flexibility, we then have the charging schedule of the battery storage and the production schedule of the machines. And flexibilities are always needed for the later optimization. So these flexibilities result in 3 optimization scenarios. The first one, battery control. The second one, production scheduling. And the third one is combining both battery control and production scheduling. The goal is always to decrease the energy costs via increasing the self-consumption and increasing the system efficiency. To optimize this, we first need simple models of the system. Here we can again see the system and all possible power flows. The PV system is always an energy supplier, and the machines are always energy consumers. The grid and the battery can act as both consumers and suppliers. Next, I will shortly talk about the submodels of the individual components, which are needed for the later optimization. For the machines, digital models based on machine learning are available from another research group at the FHV. There, long short-term memory, so machine learning, was used to estimate the energy consumption of the robot. Here we can see the digital twin and the real machine. And in the bottom, we can see the estimation of the electrical power. We can see that all in all, it works fine. And there's just narrow at the start because at the moment the startup isn't considered. And here we can see some small errors. One is where the gripper picks up the product, the second one where it releases, because at the moment only the electrical motors are considered, but not the gripper. the rest will be added soon. So this is then used as digital twin. And next we can see the model of the battery storage. For the battery storage, we can just write the energy balances, but I think these are not so important today. Using the digital twin of the model and the energy balances, we can then optimize the system. For the optimization, we are using mixed integer linear programming. This has the benefits that it's fast and finds the global minima. The optimization problem can be split into the cost function, an energy flow, and a production scheduling optimization. First, we need to define the cost function. Here we want to cover a broad range. So the cost function consists of the costs of the power peak, the costs of the energy, and the battery costs. The battery costs are the investment and degradation costs of the battery. For the energy flow optimization, we can then use the energy balance of the system, which was shown before, and the energy balance of the battery model as constraints. The last part of the optimization is the production scheduling. Our constraints are here, the allowed time range for every job. So every job has a start date and a finish date. Next, every job must run once, and jobs can't be interrupted as soon as they are started. Also, jobs can't run parallel. And at the end, we're calculating the resulting load profile out of the estimations from the digital twin for every job. Altogether, the energy flows and the production plan can now be optimized. So let's talk about the results. Here we can see the results of the simulation study for 1 month using spot market prices. Left, we can always see the reference case. In the reference case, the production starts as soon as the production order list arrives. There we can see a clear mismatch between production and energy supply. This can be seen in a low self-consumption. The next case is the optimal battery control. This can be seen here. We can see that with optimal battery control, the costs aren't really better than the reference case. This is due to the high investment costs and degradation costs of the battery. But these are also calculated with electricity prices from last year, so this year it would look different. The next scenario then is production scheduling. Here we can see that the costs decreased a lot and are way better than with the other two cases. And this is due to the high self-consumption, because the jobs with the highest demand are always scheduled to the times with the highest energy supply. Last, we can see battery control and production scheduling together. Both together are just slightly better than just production scheduling. But these simulations always assume perfect predictions. As soon as uncertainties need to be taken into account, the battery storage has high potential. The production schedule can't be spontaneously changed, but the battery can react very fast. We can see this in the model predictive control concept from the next slide. Here we are using model predictive control to react to weather changes. In the morning, we optimize both the battery control and the production schedule. Then we continuously optimize the battery control to react to uncertainties. We can see it here. If we get a new PV forecast with a big drop here, we optimize again, resulting in a different battery control. The battery here compensates the drop so that the load profile doesn't get a big peak here, which would increase the costs a lot. So let's come to the summary. We provide a mixed integer linear programming formulation of a battery-supported factory with on-site generation. We showed that this formulation can be used for optimizing the battery control and the production scheduling. And the next step is, of course, a proof of concept with a real implementation. This was one use case of a digital twin where we showed how they can be used to optimize a manufacturing process. Thank you very much. And if you have any questions, feel free to ask them now.
Thank you, Philipp. Very interesting, especially the combination of a digital twin with mixed linear integer programming. Like in my experience, this is always challenging because mixed linear integer programming has so many constraints, like not constraints in the model, but it has very strict demands on which kind of constraint or parameter you can use. So you really need to put a lot of thought into coupling mixed linear integer programming with a digital twin that's clearly nonlinear. And actually, I wanted to ask, like, did I understand this correctly, that you sort of only use the digital twin before the optimization to get the right parameters for the optimization step? Is that right?
Yes.
So you get the power consumption for each schedule.
Yeah, the load profile for each schedule. And then we're using these to optimize it. And at the end, we can then give the complete one the optimized order back to the digital twin to see how that would look like, if it's better. And if it's better, we can then use it.
Mm-hmm. So would you dare to sort of guess where the biggest error is coming from? Like, is it the prediction of the digital twin, or is it like the MILP optimization model that's introducing the biggest deviation?
I would say at the moment, the predictions which we are using at the MILP, like the weather forecast, they are introducing a lot of errors. But I would say that the digital twin estimates the power consumption very good, so the rest would introduce the bigger error at the moment.
Mm-hmm.
But at the moment, it's just a guess, so we haven't implemented it yet because due to Corona, the battery storage, the real one, still wasn't delivered, but it should come next month, so.
All right, so fingers crossed.
Yeah, hopefully.
I was also wondering how you took the data from the digital twins calculated the MILP model with it, because this graph here on the lower side, it looks very rigid. So it's not very smooth. And to work in mixed integer linear programming, you have to discretize your time frame. And I guess there you have to make big approximations, isn't that right?
Yeah, the time schedules, they are at the moment completely different, because we are looking at the extra spot market prices, and there we just have a price for 15 minutes. And the power consumption from the model, it can estimate or predictive in milliseconds. So there we are at the moment always summing them up, like how much power does it or energy is it using in 5 minutes, and then we're using that one.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so you're optimizing on a 5 minute interval. But how many time steps do you use in your models?
But then it's calculated for the optimizer to 15 minutes, which would be 96 time steps per day.
Okay. And you're always optimizing for 1 day in advance?
Always for 1 day in advance. So.
Okay. Okay, thank you.
I have one question. Is it possible to ask?
Sure. Go ahead. Okay.
Thank you. As I understand, this digital twin I mean, the optimizer is between the digital twin and the real factory here. So should, if this digital twin is connected directly to the factory, then the optimizer can be, I mean, can act on the digital twin to optimize, or because here in this slide, I see that the digital twin is not connected to the factory. Maybe I'm wrong, I don't know.
I mean, that's just for the information flow at the moment, but also this one here is directly forwarded through. So the digital twin is connected.
It's connected through the optimizer, right?
Yeah, in reality, we have Terneel factory here with the MES system, SCADA and everything.
Okay.
And there we have a server where the optimizer is running as Python code, and also the digital twin is running in the simulation system of an industry partner, Eberle Autonomous Systems, and there it runs as functional mock-up unit.
So, and if the digital twin should be updated with the new with the evolving mechanism of the system, so did you take into account the this changing mechanism in the optimization model itself? I mean, instead of having like the mixed integer linear program or instead of formulating this, did you take into account the stochastic aspect of this process? I mean, or just formulate this with the constraint, then, I mean, it's just one optimization problem formulated in the terms of objectives and constraints, and you fix it, right?
At the moment, it's just a one optimization problem.
Okay.
So, I mean, if I understood correctly, at some point at the beginning, you said that your colleagues are responsible for the connectivity of the digital twin, right? Like this deriving the LSTM models from data to get the model for the digital twin that you're using in the optimization.
Yeah. We have here two research groups, one the digital factory, and I'm from the research center energy, so we are more focusing on the energy and the scheduling, and the others are more focusing on the digital twin, where they are using machine learning and things like that. And they also create a real-time measurement concept so that the data can always be measured, so the twin also gets feedback how good its predictions were or how the machines are. So.
Hello, I would also have a question. Martin Pazzona from TNG is speaking. Regarding the effort to add a new machine, a new device to the factory, how much effort would this be? Or can you use like a template, a rough model, and then just maybe that it's optimized based on a rough or a template, I would say, like a template.
I know at the start there were just these two robots.
Okay.
Then everything was done for them, and then later the other three ones were added, which are different robots from a different manufacturer, and the machine learning algorithm can be applied to them as well. So other robots are easy to integrate, but for example, for the milling machine, I think that there should be some adaptations because it's completely different. But
yes, this is what I have expected and what I have also seen. Yeah, if they are similar devices, then it works. If they're completely different devices, then it has to be checked. Yeah, thanks for your answer.
Yeah.